So my name is Setsuko Winchester, and as he said, my project is called Freedom from Fear, Yellow Ball Project. I was born in New York City. I'm an American, and I did this project because I didn't know anything about Asian American history, and I didn't know about the forced removal and mass incarceration, for example. So after I married this man, this is my husband, Simon Winchester. He's a writer. He has the luxury of being able to really delve into history, you know, not just look at the daily news and you forget about what happened, but you get to really explore context, and which is really important in today's world, I think. And so he came along with me for the ride on this journey to find out what happened to Japanese Americans back in the 1940s and earlier, which has everything to do with what happened to them at that time. So anyway, he is my partner in crime. And basically in January 6th of 1941, FDR gave his famous Four Freedoms speech, which said that everyone anywhere in the world should be eligible for the following four freedoms. And they were freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom from want, and freedom from fear. And that was the main focus of my project, was freedom from fear. Because when you look at it, I would be what you were supposed to be afraid of. They were afraid of the yellow peril.
So the what happened on the 19th of February, 1942, some months after the attack on Pearl Harbor, was that President Roosevelt signed Executive Order 9066, which consigned some 120,000 people of Japanese ethnicity, of about 75% of whom were American citizens, to go to what were called relocation centers, camps dotted around in very remote locations west of the Mississippi River. And the people that they were excluding, and there are two maps that are sort of relevant to this story, lived in the west of the states of Washington, Oregon, California, and southern Arizona. So anyone living in those parts of the United States who were of Japanese ethnicity were ordered to report to a number of what were called assembly centers, which are identified largely by those circles there, while these 10 concentration camps were readied in the innermost states up to the Mississippi River.
Yeah. So the places that we went to were these places with the big triangles: Heart Mountain, Minidoka, Tule Lake, Topaz, Manzanar, Post and Gila River, Granada, and Roer and Jerome. So we came from Massachusetts and drove to the six camps, southern camps first, in December of 2015. And I didn't know that there were camps as far east as Arkansas. And there were two of these camps were placed, you know, right by the Mississippi. The other camps, the ones with the stars, these are the internment camps. See where all the stars are? And the internment camps, the reason why it's important is because they were run by the Justice Department. To be in an internment camp, you had to be charged with a crime. You were given a trial. And if you could not prove your innocence, then you were either deported or you were put into prison. So that's what an internment camp were. And they existed at the same time as the war, as the military war relocation centers. But also within the administration, they were called concentration camps. FDR called for the creation of concentration camps as early as 1936. And it was on a plan for what to do if there was an invasion on the West Coast by the head of the Navy. 15-point plan number 12 was like, you know, concentration camps for ethnically Japanese. So they were called concentration camps, and I'll explain the difference later. But anyway, so immediately after Pearl Harbor, FDR called for a travel ban, a curfew, and the immediate roundup of about 2,000 individuals into these internment camps. About 9,000, immediately after that, there was a lot of pressure from the government telling people of Japanese ethnicity that they should leave the West Coast. So about 9,000 of them packed up and left and tried to go past this line and into the following states. And when they got there, most of the states said, no Japs are allowed. If they're dangerous over there, then they're dangerous over here. And if any of them crosses the line into the next state over, there's going to be Japs hanging from the trees. So then the military, and also what happened was, is as they were making their way over, people, they would run out of gas, and people wouldn't sell them gas. They wouldn't sell them food. They wouldn't give them shelter. So the government had created a refugee crisis within their own state. These people had no place to go, and they were camping out in parks and things like that. So the government said, okay, everyone back. So they made all these people go back to their home. So essentially, they were told that they were not allowed to stay, but they also were not allowed to leave. So it's this strange catch-22. And so then a year later, after the Four Freedoms speech and the attack of Pearl Harbor, FDR signs Executive Order 9066.
So what did you do to memorialize this event? I mean, that's the crucial thing.
So once I found out about this whole story and about where these people actually went, the U.S. citizens of Japanese ethnicity, and they actually rounded up anybody with 1/16th blood. They rounded them up out of orphanages. There were, you know, there was a lot of half-Japanese kids who were essentially not allowed to exist because there were miscegenation laws. So they were in orphanages, and they were rounded up by and put into these camps. What I decided to do was, I, as a ceramicist, I wanted to create a piece of conceptual artwork. It's about trying to give voice to an idea. You know, freedom from fear, what did that mean? And for these people, so I took 120 yellow tea bowls, which I hand-pinched, glazed them yellow to represent the yellow peril, and I took them to all 10 of these camps.
And 120, why?
One for every 1,000 individuals that were incarcerated.
And I seem to remember that at one stage you thought of leaving them at each of the camps. Therefore, if there were 10 camps, that would mean making 1,200 bowls.
Yeah.
That is a huge number of bowls.
Yeah.
You'd get repetitive strain injury and all the rest of it.
No, so I started getting carpal tunnel.
Yeah. So,
and also, we had an opportunity. My husband had a speech that he had to give in California, and he said, instead of me flying out there, why don't we drive out there with the bowls and visit the camps? And that's when I thought, instead of leaving 120 at each of the 10 camps, I would document 120 at each of the places with a photograph. So that's what happened. So this is the first camp we visited. It's in Rower, Arkansas. This is the chimney. This is one of the only remaining structures from that period, and that's from the hospital. So you can see how far away that is. This was vast. This camp and the other one next 26 miles away in Jerome, and this is also one of the only structures that's left. And also there's always a cemetery at these places. So the cemetery remains. But these two became like the fourth and fifth largest city in the state of Arkansas. So, when we came here, when we were looking, there is actually an interpretive center right in the middle between the two, 13 miles in between. And when we got to the internment center, when we were looking for it, there was a sign that said, you know, Japanese American World War II internment museum to the left. And the sign was sort of shot off, was missing a corner. So we go down the street and we get to the museum, and we walk in. There's not many people there, We walk inside, and there's this petite, you know, sort of dirty blonde-haired woman, and she starts to welcome, you know, us to the museum and starts explaining the internment of Japanese Americans. And the whole time I'm thinking, I'm just really distracted, and I say to her, after a while, I said, you know, can I ask you a question? I said, what's with that sign up the street? And she says, what sign? I said, you know, the one that's kind of shot off. She goes, oh, that, yeah, well, you know. So I said, no, I don't know. So she said, well, you know, things happen. So I said, like what? You know, so she said, well, sometimes you come in and, you know, people have done damage or vandalism, you know. She said, sometimes they come in and they, you know, yell at you, like, why are you, you know, create a museum for people that tried to kill us and still are. You should be ashamed of yourself. And so I said to her, you know, do you feel unsafe? And she's like, well, you know, to tell you the truth, most people don't even know what we're doing here. You know, they don't know what this is. They, you know. So I said, well, can I ask you a question? I said, you're not Japanese, you know, you're not Japanese American, you know, I don't know if you're, you know, you're married to a Japanese person, no. And so I said, so why are you doing this? Why are you, you know, doing this history that's so, you know, vilified, or, you know, that local people don't really want to know. So she said to me, my father worked at the camps. He said that those people were innocent, that they didn't do anything wrong, and they didn't deserve to be here. So she said, I'm doing it because it's the right thing to do. And for me, she has been an inspiration to me, because I felt like I'm Japanese American and I never bothered to find out about this history. And here is this woman, you know, facing the condemnation of her neighbors in order to do this. So every day I think, you know, nobody's interested, nobody wants to know, you know, everybody tells you to shut up or not interested, get out, you know. I think about that woman, and I think, you know, American history is important, and this history was about Americans and what happened in America, you know. She is a story that I always think about when I do.
So I should say that these are in the floodplain of the Mississippi, just north of Louisiana. Mosquitoes and mud, and it was pretty horrible. This was a lovely, cool winter's day, but you can imagine this great assembly of tar paper shacks and immense overcrowding and, you know, guards and watchtowers. Miserable, miserable place. But we left there, and George Takei, you may know, I'm sure you know, he was...
Oh, he was star. At the other one. He was at Rower, yeah.
So after a time there, we left and headed west in the car across Texas and across New Mexico, and eventually ended up in Arizona, where there were two camps, rather like in Arkansas, two in Arizona. And the first one we went to was on the banks of the Colorado River just before you enter California. And it's this one here called Poston.
Yeah. So Poston is, it's significant because it's on Native American land. It's on the Colorado Indian reservation. And this was one of the largest camps in the group. And it's one of the only places that had adobe brick. Most of them were clapboard. You know, this has real adobe. And this was the only area where any of the original structures remained. And also that water tower is still from that period. But this supposedly was like, you know, probably the school or something like that. But here in this photo, you could see that I hand-pinched them in families. So this is supposed to be like, you know, mom and dad, and then the teenager, and then the little baby. And so each family group is pinched and glazed, and they have the same foot. So it's supposed to represent, you know, individuals and people. So that's what...
I thought the extraordinary thing about this camp was how unfamiliar the locals were with its existence.
Yeah.
I mean, you couldn't find anyone that knew where it was. And in the end, you went to a little store, didn't you, a gas station?
Yeah. Well, we tried to find it, and we drove right past it. And we thought, wait, it had to have been here. So then we drove back and we saw Woody's convenience store. And I was asking everybody, where was the, you know, where's the internment camp? Is there anything that we can see or whatever? And everybody said, not sure what you're talking about. And then they finally said, ask Woody. Woody's in the back in the, you know, freezer, you know, getting out some stuff. So he finally comes out and he said, oh yeah, you know, there's this small clutch of buildings that have been preserved. You could go there. And so we went there, and it was all surrounded by barbed wire and fences. And we saw this car, and there were two girls sitting in it, and we weren't sure. We thought, oh, maybe we're not supposed to be here or whatever. And I guess they thought, oh, maybe we are not. They didn't want to be seen either. But then we ended up running into them, and they said, oh, if you want to get in there, there's a hole in the back. The big hole, and so you can sort of go in that way. So they followed us around, and it turns out they didn't know anything about these camps either. And it turns out the reason is because when Milton Eisenhower was the first director of this WRA that was established by executive order, after executive order 9066, there was a huge series of executive orders that were passed in order to make this possible. And Milton Eisenhower, as the head, had to figure out, where to put these people. So originally they were put into assembly centers, but then you had to build these more permanent camps. And all the governors in the state said, if they're dangerous in your state, we don't want them here. So somebody said, well, how about putting them on Indian land? So they said, okay, let's go to the Secretary of Interior. So they go to the Secretary of Interior and they ask the Native tribes. To their credit, most of the Native Americans said, we do not want to do to a group of people the same thing that was done to us. And they said no, except for two of the tribes, and this is one of them, the Poston Colorado Indian tribe. And at the time, it was very divisive. Most of the people said no, but some of the leadership said after they were told by the government, the military said, what if we bring in infrastructure like pipes and roads and schools and buildings and housing? And so they were like, okay. So that's how the Japanese Americans ended up there. There's a coda to the story. After the war ended and they got rid of all the people, the government came in and they removed most of the infrastructure that was put in. They removed all the pipes, they removed all the buildings, because they said they needed material for the soldiers who were returning home. So that's why it was seen as a shame and shameful, and there's embarrassment about that. So no one talks about it. Yeah.
So we then crossed, heading west still, because I had to give this talk at Caltech. So we crossed the Colorado River into Southern California, and an interesting thing happened when we were staying on the campus at Caltech, a speech that you heard on the television, which suddenly put all this into focus,
yeah.
If you can remember.
Yeah. So,
well, yeah, yes. Yeah. The next slide is, yeah. Well, in that case, we turned round after Caltech. But I think it's relevant to say what you heard at Caltech before I go to the next step.
Well, he had to give a speech at Caltech. So supposedly there was a fancy dress event and we were put into the Einstein suite. So I thought, oh, this is where Einstein stayed when he stayed at Caltech. And I thought, oh, that's really neat. And so I took my fancy dress and I put it in the shower to steam because it was all wrinkly. And I turned on CNN and there was, this was December 2015, and there was candidate Trump. He had just declared his presidency in July of 2015, and he was saying FDR was a great man, he was a great president. Everybody loves FDR. He used internment for the Japanese people, and I think it could be a solution for the Muslim problem.
So all of a sudden, it seemed entirely relevant to what we were doing.
Yeah.
So after that speech and armed with this knowledge, we then sort of retraced our steps to the most, probably the best known of the 10 concentration camps in Southern California, and that is Manzanar.
Yeah. So this is the next day after I saw that, that I came to Manzanar. This is a replica of one of the guard towers where you would have military soldiers with rifles pointing in at the inmates, not out to protect them, as some officials said. And here you can see that I arranged the T-bowls into like rectangles, because that's supposed to mimic the barracks. That's how all the barracks were. Yeah, this is, it's like right by Death Valley.
Death Valley would be off to the left,
yeah.
And the southern Sierras with Mount Whitney and so forth are where Setsuko's standing, Los
yeah.
Angeles.
Even if you tried to escape, you wouldn't get very far. You know, it was so isolated. And you could see why there's still no one living there now. Yeah.
But this is a National Park Service site, so...
Yeah. There's a very, very good interpretive center here, yeah.
But as I think, as you've mentioned, it's an unfunded mandate, which means that they run out of electricity and internet, and they have to furlough the staff every so often.
Yeah, they always run out
of
money all the time.
100% yeah. Commitment by the U.S. government.
Yeah.
So having been then to Manzanar, which is the subject of many books, not least Farewell to Manzanar, a very famous one, we then headed back into Arizona, over the Colorado River, this time heading south of Tucson and onto another Native American reservation, much more organized than the Colorado River tribe, and it's called
Gila River.
Gila yeah. River.
So this is Gila River. The reason why this is a little bit different from Poston is this is sovereign Indian land. You cannot, it's hard to get on here. In order for me to get permission to do this project, I had to submit a request, and there was a long process. They said it would take a year, but because I said, well, I have this opportunity to go out west, you know, so they expedited the process for me and, you know, went through the tribal process and they gave me special access. And this was also vast. This was the school. The cement padding where the school was. And up here is the water tower from the original camps. And up here is a memorial to the 442nd and 100th Battalion, the men who were recruited out of the camps, the concentration camp, U.S. concentration camps, to go fight in Europe. So this pattern, I put it, it mirrors the arch up here. So that's what this is about.
So then it's now getting, it's in middle of December, and we have to get back to Massachusetts for Christmas and all that good stuff. So we headed east over the Rockies, a phenomenal snowstorm. We had to wait a couple of days and then go over this particular pass, come down the other side into the rain shadow of the Rockies and into Colorado, where there is one camp called Amache or Granada,
yeah, yeah.
And that's here.
Yeah. So this camp, Colorado, was significant because after the Indians, you know, only two tribes said yes, they were like, okay, well, we still need more places and, you know, states to take these people. Finally, Governor Carr of Colorado, he was one of the most popular governors at the time. And he said, I will take these people. These people are good people. They didn't do anything wrong. And, you know, I'll take anyone you have. And he said, and they're, by the way, very talented farmers. So that's when Milton Eisenhower said, oh, why don't we go to the Farm Bureau? So he went to the Farm Bureau. Said, hey, you know, do any of you guys want any of these people? They're really good farmers. All of a sudden, governor from Arkansas, former head of the KKK, says, I'll take two camps, right? Idaho, Wyoming, you know, all these states that have passed all these anti-Asian, anti-Japanese laws, all of a sudden we're taking them. But they said, we'll only take them if they're put into prisons with barbed wire and with guards with rifles and, you know, military watching these people. That's the only way we'll take them.
So then we left and went back to Massachusetts and then decided to do the northern tier states once the snows had melted up there. And so we then headed out in April, May, now heading up to Chicago and through the Dakotas to the first of the camps that we came to in the north, and that was in Wyoming, and that is a camp called Heart Mountain.
So this is one of the few places where the original structure is still there, and that's the original chimney, that was the hospital. And Heart Mountain has it has a private interpretive center, which is amazing. It was one of the best places I've ever went to. The history is very comprehensive. The reason why Heart Mountain is important is because this is where the 66 resistors were. And the 66 resistors were, in 1943, the government knew that there were four cases that were going to the Supreme Court trying to prove that this was unconstitutional. So there were a lot of people in the government saying, we got to do something. We can't just hold these people indefinitely. And Eleanor Roosevelt herself was saying, if we don't do something, we're going to have another Native American Indian problem on our hands, where you just have a bunch of people on reservations. So, one of the things was the loyalty questionnaire, and I'll explain that in a second. But they basically encouraged boys in the camp or anybody who was eligible to go volunteer to go fight, in Europe or Japan for the four freedoms, elsewhere. And needless to say, most of the 442nd came from Hawaii. At the initial, call for duty. A lot of the Japanese Americans on the mainland did not go. And so because of that, what they did was to, they drafted them. So they drafted anybody who was eligible to have to join the army to go fight from the U.S. concentration camps. So 66 of them in Heart Mountain said, you can't, first you said that we're 4C enemy alien and that we're not eligible to fight. And they had actually removed Japanese Americans from the military who were already who were already soldiers.
They tried them in federal court.
They tried them.
66 people. I mean, a huge courtroom thing, and they've all found guilty, and were all sent off to federal prison at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas, which seems a monstrous, injustice, just another layer of injustice being laid on the original one. I should say, Heart Mountain is called Heart Mountain because in the background there, slightly to more or less where I'm standing, there is a beautiful heart-shaped mountain. On the day before this photograph was taken, it was entirely and beautifully visible. However, then up north in Canada, the Fort McMurray fires were burning and the wind changed, and this is all smoke coming down from Alberta, which made the place look grey and miserable and robbed us of the opportunity to take the picture of Heart Mountain itself. So then we left there and drove further west still to southern Idaho, just sort of north of the potato fields and near the mountains, where there is a camp called Minidoka.
So this photo is one of my favorite photos because to me, it sort of illustrates the feeling that I had about what was coming. And there's this storm coming, and I was trying to lay out all the tables as best as I can before the storm came. And I feel like I captured it pretty well. And this is sort of like a metaphor for what's happening now. But Minidoka also now has a very active interpretive center, and they're doing all kinds of research about this history. So if you get a chance, I would definitely go there.
And then before we get to the next camp, some explanation is necessary, because the people that went to the next camp, which is called Tule Lake, were those that were answered in a wrong sense, if I can put it like that, these two questions in the following questionnaire.
Yeah. So like I said, as these Supreme Court cases were coming up, they knew that they were going to question the constitutionality of what the government had done. So there were forces trying to figure out a way to make, you know, some of these people be able to leave. And so what they did was they made anybody that was over 16 answer, I think it was like 30, over 30 questions, and it was called the loyalty questionnaire. And a lot of people were like, why are we doing a loyalty questionnaire? Because we were originally put in here because the government claimed that you could not distinguish loyalty, therefore everyone had to go, including children and, you know, kids in orphanages. So, but anyway, you had to answer these questions. And the two questions, The two questions, question number 27 said, are you willing to serve in the armed forces of the United States on combat duty wherever ordered? Most of them said yes, but if you qualified it in any way, like, you know, as soon as you let me out the front gate, I'll be the first one to sign up. Or, you know, if you also release my parents and my wife and my children, if you qualified this question in any way, it was considered a no, even if you said yes. And a lot of people said no. And then question 28, it said, will you forswear unqualified allegiance to the United States of America and faithfully defend the United States from any or all attack by foreign or domestic forces? Most of the people said, yes, of course. But then it said, and forswear any form of allegiance or obedience to the Japanese emperor or any other foreign government. People were like, I'm an American, I've never been to Japan, I don't even speak Japanese, and he is not my emperor. So a lot of people said, you know, of course I'll do yes, but, you know, he's not my emperor. So if you qualified that in any way, that was also considered a no. Or a lot of people just thought that it's a trick question. You know, if you said yes, it means you're saying that you are obedient to the Japanese emperor. So people wrote no. So two no's were called the no-no boys. All the no-nos at all of the camps were all sent to the following camp, Tule Lake. That's why Tule Lake is one of the most important camps of all of the 10. They had a prison within a prison, And this was the jail, and the day we went there, there was a National Park Service person, and we went into one of the cells, and there were 10 children and the interpretive person, and it was pretty tight in the cell. They had 25 men in there. It was so crowded that people couldn't all lie down at the same time. They had to switch to try to get some sleep. And some people were in there for months or almost a year. And the other thing that was interesting about this camp was that when I went there, I talked to... I'm trying to remember his name. He was a really great
National Park Service guy.
But I asked at all the camps, you know, do you ever see any trouble or whatever? And at this place, he said, well, you know, well, what do you mean by trouble? So I explained about the first camp we went to and the sign was shot up, and he said, well, you know, this is, you know, the West, everybody has a gun, you know, so, you know, everything gets shot up. It's hard to know if it was for racist reasons or not. But I will tell you one thing. He said, ever since last December, when Mr. Trump said that FDR had used, you know, Executive Order 9066 and internment for the Japanese people, a lot of people have been coming because they never heard of any of these camps, but they wanted to know how internment works because they heard it was a solution for the Muslim problem. Yeah. So, So between December of 2015 until this was April of 2016, all of a sudden there was this sudden interest in, and they were having people visit, not to learn about a dark side of American history, but to find out about a very, you know, effective way of solving security problems. And nobody challenged that. Nobody was talking about the unconstitutionality of this. That's why it's extremely dangerous, the way it's been characterized historically and the way it was characterized by Mr. Trump and, you know, both administrations in many ways. I thought it was interesting here
that there were a group of school children from Southern Oregon, I think, who had come to see it. And quite audibly, I mean, to both of us, one of them said to another, "Oh, here comes a Jap," pointing at Setsi. Yeah. And the teacher knew that we had heard. So these kids were forced to apologize.
They came up so contrite and terribly
sorry.
"I'm sorry, we didn't mean it." And actually, one of them was Mexican, one was Indian, one was like a red-haired, you know, white Irish-looking boy. Yeah. So they were all tweeting, you know, all the Japs, you know, it's a joke. Like, they think it's a joke. Not taught otherwise, you know, and that's the problem. Yeah.
So that was as far west as we got, and then we turned around to go to the final camp, which was in southern Utah, called Topaz.
Yeah. So this is Block 22. And the reason why I put this in this configuration is because Block 22 is where the church was. A lot of these camps had churches because a lot of Japanese Americans had, the early ones, most of whom had come before 1908, because the gentleman's agreement was signed, and which excluded all immigration from Japan to the United States in 1908. So most of these people had come, you know, by 1941, most of them were born in the United States and were American citizens. And the immigrants had come before 1901 or in 1924 at the latest, which was the Asian Exclusion Act, which banned all Asians from the United States. So anyway, so this was where the church was.
So then we left there and went back home again. But then Setsi had this bright idea of going to a number of places, five places, that were iconically important in the story. So we've been to the 10 camps now, but there are five other locations in which we took photographs.
Yeah, so there were five places that for me were landmarks that memorialize the idea of four freedoms. So In January of 2016, I actually contacted the Four Freedoms Park on the tip of Roosevelt Island in Manhattan. And I was born in Manhattan. You know, my family has an apartment right in Midtown, and there's a bridge over here over the FDR that I can run to, and I could see the tip of this island. And I thought, I want to take my T-balls here. And luckily, you know, this was 2016, Obama had been elected, you know, the people there were open to the idea and wanted to look at the dark side of FDR and his legacy. And so this is supposed to, here is a bust of FDR. On the other side of this marble wall are engraved the Four Freedoms. So this is supposed to symbolize the fact that the Yellow Peril and these Americans were excluded from those freedoms. So that's what this symbolizes.
So the next place was in where the Four Freedoms paintings, which were done by Norman Rockwell for the Saturday Evening Post covers, are held in the Norman Rockwell Museum in something called the Four Freedoms Rotunda.
Yeah. So we live in Western Massachusetts in the Berkshires. Stockbridge is just a couple of towns over from my town. And so I knew I wanted to take them to the Four Freedoms Rotunda. And I wanted to take all my 120 yellow T-bowls and to photograph them in front of Freedom from Fear. This is a painting of Norman Rockwell's Freedom from Fear, and it shows a mother and a father tucking in their children safely to bed. And I don't focus on that. I focus on the T-ball. It's supposed to be sort of, you know, this is me. You know, I'm the object of fear, and we were not excluded. So included.
Then down to Washington, D.C.
Yeah, so this is another extremely difficult image that I could not possibly not have done without the help of a Supreme Court justice. And there's so much security. In order to do this, there's a security hut in the back, and we were escorted to the basement. We had dogs sniffing our car. We had like metal detectors checking for bombs and everything. And then we had two soldiers carry our bags, escort us to the front. And I started unpacking the bowls and arranging them in this is nine justices. There are nine rows to represent nine justices. And these four represent the four people that took the case to the Supreme Court. Mitsui Endo, which her case was found unconstitutional at the time. Three others, Korematsu, Minoru Yasui, and Gordon Hirabayashi. The court, in a packed court, found it legal. So, But it was interesting because when I was doing this, a lot of people were asking me, what are you doing? And this African-American mother and son passed by. And the boy came up to me and he said, what are you doing? And so I said, this project has to do with something that happened in World War II. And it was the mass incarceration, forced removal of Japanese Americans. And he's like, what are you talking about? And I said, well, they put him into these camps. And he said, no shit. and then he goes back to his mom and he said, did you know that this happened? She's like, no shit. They were like, they couldn't believe that this happened. Yeah. So, but it was interesting. A lot of people didn't know, yeah. But there were a lot of lawyers who were saying, you know, I sort of recall something about Korematsu, but, you know, nobody really said anything. Yeah.
Then a mile away, sorry.
I think all generations are there now, the younger generations.
Yeah, well, a lot of older people don't know either. Okay. Yeah. They know it in the sense that most people say they had to be put away. I'm actually told by most, you know, older people, if you talk about this story, they say, well, you had to be put away Pearl Harbor. Yeah. And that it was legal. They say it was legal, and actually it wasn't. It was unconstitutional.
Those stories on the papers a lot of times, you
know. Well, they also say internment camps, and I'll explain that in a second.
So about a mile away?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This?
Yeah. This is the Memorial to Japanese American Patriotism, and it's about 2 minutes from Union Station. Union Station is one of the busiest places in Washington, D.C., and yet no one comes here. When we went here, it was like the favorite napping place of homeless people. Yeah. So basically what this is a statue of a crane, and it's entangled in barbed wire. And these panels have all the 10 camps, like you can see Tule Lake there. And it has the number of people who are incarcerated. So I placed all the T-balls around that column. The thing that I would like to share is that it's also a memorial to the men who went and served out of those camps. And in the end, about 33,000 Japanese Americans ended up serving in the military. In the 100th Battalion and the 442nd and the MIS, Military Intelligence Service. And in the end, 9,400 between that group, 9,486 Purple Hearts were awarded to these men, 4,000 Bronze Stars, 560 Silver Stars, 29 Distinguished Service Crosses, 21 Medals of Honor, and 7 Presidential Unit Citations. They became the most decorated military unit in U.S. military history for its size and duration. And yet, hardly anybody talks about this.
I do want to say, as a coda to this, behind roughly where Setsi is standing, there's marble or sandstone, there's a fountain, there's a reflecting pool, and chiseled into the sandstone are words which I believe I've never seen on any other official federal monument in this country. And the words are, "Here we admit a wrong." And I think that's very powerful, because we all know now that after the report in the mid-1980s and the rather puny reparations that were given to the victims of all of this, the American government has officially acknowledged that what happened in 1942 was a monstrous injustice. So here we admit a wrong, unique, and to me, as a foreigner, rather moving. Moving, however, right along to Hyde Park, New York.
So as I was going to all these iconic locations, the FDR Library found out about what I was doing. They were preparing an exhibition for the 75th anniversary of FDR signing of Executive Order 9066. And the head of the FDR Library came to me and said, "We want to invite you to create a site-specific image. You could go anywhere in the museum you wanted to." So I spent the day looking, you know, going all over the place. And I went outside and I encountered this. Oops, sorry. I saw this. This strange statue of a man and a woman, and it's at the bottom, it said, "Freedom from fear." And I said, "Oh my God, this is my spot. This is where I'm gonna put my tea bowls." So I decided that I was gonna put them in the shadow of a yellow man, just like that, you know, it's a yellow man. So it's to show that, you know, even though FDR said freedom from fear, you know, these people were not, you know, protected from fear of their own government. They were imprisoned, you know, right under FDR's nose.
The two statues.
So another thing that I found out after I did this image, I found out that these are cutouts from the Berlin Wall. And the statue was created by none other than Edwina Sands. And Edwina Sands is the granddaughter of Winston Churchill. So
she lives here above Victoria's Secret at the corner of Broadway and Prince Street in Lower Manhattan.
Yeah.
And the other weird thing about it is that an ancestor of Edwina Sands, Lord Sands, the British colonial treasurer in 1762, was the person after whom the village we live in Massachusetts, which is called Sandysfield, is named. So there are all sorts of weird
coincidences. Yeah, there's this weird connection with,
It was meant to be you should end here. So that is the project, effectively.
Yeah. So
but there are one or two things that follow, which, if you've all got time, Setsi will run through now rather rapidly, I think. So here we go.
Yeah.
Explain.
So now this comes to more contemporary. That was historic. Now, one of the things that happens in this story and why it often gets buried is because the word internment is used. They say Japanese internment camp or Japanese American internment camp. And the reason why that term is wrong is because, number one, they were not in Japan. They were not run by the Japanese government. So there's nothing Japanese about it. They were American, they were US facilities. They were, and they were also not created to imprison Japanese people. These were US citizens. The foreign nationals were put into internment camps, and one of the internment camps during World War II was Ellis Island. This is the Great Hall in Ellis Island. Ellis Island was an internment camp for German, Italian, and Japanese foreign nationals. And there were actually more German and Italians in the internment camps than there were Japanese. So when you say internment camps, that's not where Japanese, it has nothing to do with Japanese Americans, you know, or Japan. And the other thing, the other problem that's starting to happen is that people are starting to find out that Germans and Italians were put into internment camps. So some of the talks that I've given, some people come up to me and they say, well, Germans and Italians were in the internment camps too. It wasn't just the Japanese. So then you have to explain, yes, of course they were in the internment camps because that's what they were for. They were for foreign nationals. And the distinction is that they were, you had to be charged. It was run by the Justice Department, as I said before. You were given a trial, and the places were protected by the Geneva Conventions. The U.S. concentration camps for Americans of Japanese ethnicity had none of those. They were never charged with a crime. They were never given a hearing. And none of those facilities were protected by the Geneva Conventions. And by definition, they were concentration camps. Concentration camps are when individuals are rounded up for who they are, not for what they did.
And the numbers are rather different too. You took 16.
Yeah, so there's only 16 there because about 31,000 were put into the internment camps, all the internment camps. So there was about like 16,500 Italian and German foreign nationals. Predominantly German foreign nationals, and fewer Japanese foreign nationals. So to reiterate or to underline what I just said, this is the plaque at Manzanar. And if you'll look carefully, Manzanar, the first of the 10 such concentration camps. It says concentration camp. This plaque has been here since April 14th, 1973.
But I do think it's rather amusing.
It was always called concentration camps.
Who was angry about them being called concentration camps has managed to damage the sea.
Oh yeah, people come and they shoot it up, and you know, and supposedly like the grave, there were grave robbers who like dug up the graves of Japanese Americans. Yeah. So anyway. I included this because this was recently put into my local paper, the Berkshire Eagle, and it repeats a story that has been proven untrue by the FBI at the time. Herbert Hoover even said that they had found no wrongdoing by any Japanese Americans. So this is how the story perpetuates itself. All these old stories are regurgitated time and time again as if they were true. So there's, you know, you have to look at history, but there's a, you know, as we find out new things, sometimes it's a little bit different. But in many ways, the Japanese Americans were tried in the media. This is fake news. Walter Lippmann, one of the most influential columnists of his time, wrote this famous, famous piece a week before FDR signing of Executive Order 9066, and it said, the fifth column on the coast. And it basically said that we can't trust any of the Japanese. So this photograph I included, this is Heart Mountain. This is the mountain that I didn't take a picture of, and the hospital is over here. So this is how all the barracks were. They were, you know,
tar paper.
Yeah, tar paper, covered with tar paper. A lot. They had holes in it. They had gaps in it. It would be 125 degrees at night, or like minus 40 in the winter. There are stories about families digging holes underneath the barracks during the summer and putting their children in there to keep them cool, because it was so hot. But anyway, why this picture is significant is because there are a lot of things that are associated with World War II that are associated with Germany, but actually have their origins in the United States. And one of them is this. So you have all these Japanese Americans around the American flag in a U.S. concentration camp saluting the American flag with this. This is because this was not called the Nazi salute. It was actually called the Bellamy salute. And it was Francis Bellamy was the author of the Pledge of Allegiance. He wrote it in 1897, 92, I forget the exact dates, for Youth Companion magazine. And he composed the pledge, and he read it out to his editorial staff. And one of the editorial assistants stood up and clicked his heels and shot his arm out. And Francis Bellamy said, I love that. I'm going to include that in my instructions for children to do. So a lot of children in America used to do this. And it was around the 30s or the 40s that FDR actually changed it. He saw the Nazis doing this, and he changed it to putting your hand on your heart. So that's... But originally, it was very American. Yeah. So, and then recently, I was invited to bring my T-bowls to Hawaii. And the reason why Hawaii is relevant is because, unlike the mainland, it had twice as many Japanese people, people of Japanese ethnicity, had like 250,000. And yet, no one was forcibly removed from their homes or mass incarcerated. There were no concentrations in Hawaii. What they did have martial law. They had curfews. They had travel restrictions. They were basically under house arrest, but they were allowed to stay in the houses. They didn't lose their homes. And the other irony is that the general, the commanding general of Hawaii, said that he didn't want them put into camps because they needed the labor, ironically, to rebuild Pearl Harbor, which had been destroyed. Yeah. So I was. This is a beautiful house called the Lillestrand House. It's on the hill overlooking all of downtown Honolulu. And over here is like Diamond Head. This is Punchbowl Cemetery. This is like Arlington Cemetery in Hawaii, where you know a lot of people went and fought. There's a lot of people from the 442nd. And over here is Pearl Harbor. So I was invited to create a site-specific image, and I only used 16 because this was also had internment camps, not concentration camps.
And this is an internment camp. Yeah.
And this is one of the 17 internment camps that they've now uncovered on all the islands in Hawaii. This one was called Hanauliuli. It's only 40 minutes from downtown Honolulu, and yet no one knew of its existence until recently. And it was on private land, which was sold to Monsanto. And Monsanto was trying to clear the land to create this factory, and that's how they found the remains of a lot of Hanauliuli, which the inmates called Jigokudani. Jigokudani means the Valley of Hell. And so now it's it was declared a national monument by Obama in like 2007 or yeah no I guess later like 2012 or something like that. But there's still only limited number of people who are allowed to go every month, but you can visit it, and there is an effort to try to preserve this place.
But it is somewhat ironic that two of the modern evils, Roundup and genetically modified crops, are being produced in laboratories right beside where this internment camp is. And I think, there's a little bit more to say.
So, and then the reason why this is a literary magazine, 1924, you could see, right? 1924 is a very important year because that's the year that they passed the Asian Exclusion Act. This shows a pattern of exclusion that goes back. For Asians, Chinese people were the first people to be excluded in 1882. And the passage of that act force the creation of a brand new agency that never existed before, which was the INS, Immigration Naturalization Service. The issue of being white and being able to naturalize was important. So this is sort of what we're going through today, isn't it? Shall we naturalize the Japanese? Should we naturalize the Latinos? Who should we naturalize? Who can become an American, right? And a lot of it has to do with the 1790s Naturalization Act, which basically said that any alien being a white person, you know, had residency for 2 years, was of good character, blah, 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 could naturalize. But the key word was any alien. So, and being a free white person. So any alien meant that the first exclusion was the Native Americans, the native born, right? So most of the exclusion acts for Japanese, Chinese, you know, any of the other legal race laws that have been passed are based on Native American laws. That's why, you know, this is a history that if you don't understand, you can't understand race in America. It's not just black and white. It's not just about slavery. And even slaves who were, you know, supposedly deemed equal are still excluded from many things because they're not white. So it's very, very important. So anyway, that's my project. Thanks for listening. Any questions? Well, you know, a law that was passed prior to the 1882 Chinese Exclusion Act was the Page Act of 1875. And that basically said that no Chinese woman could immigrate to the United States unless she could prove she was not a prostitute. So, I mean, I'm not sure how you prove a negative. Like, how do you prove, you know, I'm not God? I don't know. But anyway, it was an impossible situation to be in. So, and then after that, there was law after law, you know, excluding Chinese from all kinds of things. And that's why being able to naturalize meant everything. It meant you could become a citizen, you could vote, you could buy land, you can, you know, it's not having it. They were able to exclude you from practicing law, you know, all kinds of things. So it's very, very important.
Do you find any, how well are these places are documented? Is there any official document anywhere, somewhere? Have, like,
yes. Oh, yeah.
Documentation or have, like, the people, well, obviously,
oh, yeah.
The people in those camps would probably have some documentation about their condition and stuff like that.
Oh yeah, there's a lot of oral histories. There's actually a lot of memoirs. There's a lot of historical work that's been done. Amazing, amazing work. And people keep saying to me, why don't your people speak up? And I say, they have. And I've looked historically. People have spoken up time and time and time again. They're just excluded. Like me, I've actually been excluded. You know, even though I was invited by the FDR Library, I was excluded from the New York Historical Society. I was excluded from CUNY's Roosevelt House. I was excluded. I was excluded from George Washington University Museum. I was excluded. Yeah, yeah. I mean, yeah. No. And I was actually told that I was going to be part of it. I didn't find out that I wasn't in the New York Historical Society because my project was supposed to follow the Four Freedoms paintings by Norman Rockwell as part of the historical section of the Four Freedoms story. And
it should be said that these four paintings are on a world tour. Or yeah. At least an American tour with one stop in France.
Yeah,
as
the
well.
Norman Rockwell Museum had an exhibition planned to try to replicate an exhibition that happened 75 years before. In 1943, there was enthusiasm for the war was kind of waning. You know, after Midway. The whole government knew that there was no chance of military invasion by the Japanese. Their navy had been decimated, you know. And there was concern about what to do with these people.
To whip up fervor.
Yeah. So to whip up patriotism. The government said, what could we do? And during World War I, they had traveled around with the Liberty Bell. And so they're like, let's try to find something like that. And they're like, oh, Norman Rockwell's Four Freedoms. And so they took the paintings, and it traveled around the country, all over the country for 2 years. And that's why these paintings are so famous and iconic. So they're trying to replicate that all over again. So I thought, oh my God, you know, they're gonna do this again. But they cannot exclude the Japanese American experience, you know? So I was heartened to find out that they invited me to be on the scholars board. They said that my project would be part of the way they would explain the forced removal and mass incarceration. And the day I went to the opening, we were a little bit late. And the invitation said 6:30 to 7, the exhibition would be open for people to see. And I got there around 7, like 6, whatever, like 6:45. I ran into some people on the scholars board, and then I was like, oh, it's almost 7, I better go. And the door was shut. And I knocked on the door, and they're like, can I help you? And I said, you know, can I see the exhibit? They said, sorry, close promptly at 7. So I said, oh, well, I'm one of the artists. He said, be that as it may, we close promptly at 7. Sorry. And I'm standing out there thinking, oh my God, you know, are they serious? Like, they're not going to let me see this? And then a few minutes later, two tall, really tall women come walking up next to me. And they go up to the glass door and they're like, knock on the door. And they said, they're not going to let you in. You know, they said that the door closes promptly at 7. So, and they said, no, but we're related to the artist, you know. So they knock on the door and they're like, you know, can we go in? They're like, no, sorry, you can't come in. Promptly at 7. So the three of us are standing there like dumbfounded looking at each other. And she says, so what artists are you? No, so I said, oh, so, you know, who are you related to? What artists are you related to? And she said, Norman Rockwell. He's my grandfather, and the other woman was Norman Rockwell's daughter. So I'm standing here with Norman Daisy Rockwell. And so then she says to me, so what artist are you? And I was like, oh my, I'm so embarrassed. You've never heard of me. You know, I was like, you know. She goes, no, you know, what's your name? So I said, Setsuko Winchester. She said, oh my God, the Yellow Bowl Project. She's like, I love it. You know, I love it. It's fantastic. So she said, but you know, I have to tell you something. It's not going to be here in the New York Historical Society. It's going to open up tomorrow across the park at the Roosevelt House. So, you know, we went home kind of disappointed, but oh well. So the next day, 10:30, opening at the Roosevelt House. And I run again into some friends, you know, flown in from California for the that was on the board with me. And Simon runs through the whole exhibit, runs through the whole thing. And then he comes up to me and he says, you're not going to believe this. And I said, what do you mean? And he said, it's not here either. And I said, what? And I was like shaking, because now this is really weird, because Daisy Rockwell, she's one of the curators and written one of the essays, you know, in the catalog. And, you know, she told me I was in the show. And so, sure enough, I wasn't in there. So a friend of mine on the board says, let's ask the curator. Her name was Deborah Gardner, and she passed by, and he said, Deborah, you know, so where is her piece? And she's like, what piece are you talking about? So she's like, it's the Yellow Bowl Project. So she's like, you know, what is it? Is it a sculpture? Is it a video? What, you know, what is it? And I said, well, it's a photograph, you know, yellow tea bowls, you know, went to the camps. And she's like, you know, what's your name? And I said, Setsuko Winchester. She's like, sorry, never heard of you. You know? Yeah. So, and then I'm like, wow, this is really strange. So, and then I started making a fuss. I said, you know, you cannot do a show about the Four Freedoms and exclude this story, you know? That's just wrong. Plus, I was told that I was going to be in the show, and I started speaking loudly to the security guard, and then to the information desk lady. I said, these people are censoring history. And all of a sudden she said, oh my God, wait, I never heard of you. It's not my fault. It's the Norman Rockwell Museum. Talk to, Stephanie Plunkett. So we were taken upstairs in the Roosevelt House. And they said, I'm sorry, things got a little crazy. We did send it to them. They said they didn't want it. The other side is saying they never got it. It's this mix-up. But in the end, I wasn't in the show. But they said, you know what, we'll put it in there. So they did get into the show for about, 2 weeks before we found out that the whole exhibit had been removed and taken to some undisclosed location because of air conditioning failure. But we learned from when he tried to find it, he was told by the security guard that, we're doing like this major air conditioning renovation, that's been planned for over a year. So it wasn't a sudden breakdown.
I want to mention one thing about Paulson, because I went to the Isamu Noguchi Museum.
Yeah.
And they had an exhibit where he apparently, he was famous as a sculptor.
Yes.
And recognized as, Japanese American sculptor.
Yeah. He voluntarily went, yes. Yeah. Yeah.
To bring publicity to the internment camp. And basically, that's one of the things that, as far as, it's also low profile. Unless somebody looks into, the artist or whatever it is, that was the first time I heard about Paulson, because I heard about Man's and Arthur.
Right, right.
Farewell to Man's Arthur. Yeah. There were one or two films, like some color film, and there's one black and white about the Japanese regiment.
Yeah.
But this kind of thing is very low profile.
Yeah.
You have to look for it.
Right,
it's
right.
It's not mainstream. Like, Holocaust movies are endless.
Yeah,
endless.
Yeah, yeah.
And they keep making it in Europe, basically, and the Jewish, whatever it's called, the lobby, it's high profile in American media. And so that never dies, but the Japanese experience and whatever it is with the non-white minorities is low profile. And that has to do with the mainstream press. They don't bring it up into the mainstream.
Well, it's
for the general public to learn, and it's never brought up in American history class. It's not part of the curriculum.
Yeah. I don't use concentration camps because I just choose to do that. I use it because it was FDR's term. FDR used concentration camps. He called for them. And also, I'd like to say the history of concentration camps predates Nazi Germany. It was first used by the Spanish during the Spanish-American War to round up and incarcerate Cubans. Mm-hmm. And then who won the Spanish-American War?
Yeah, all right, so we won the war.
The Americans, right? And they got all these colonies now, Cuba, Puerto Rico, Guam,
Philippines.
Yeah, the Philippines is where the Americans used concentration camps against the Filipinos. The British he's the first one to admit it. He told me about the British concentration camps, that the Brits used them before the Germans, and the Germans actually studied the British concentration camps. And the Germans actually used concentration camps first in Germany, in Namibia.
With the Herero people in 1906.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, and they actually created an innovation. The Brits had a segregated black-white concentration camps, but the Germans, the first innovation from that of black and white was the death camp. Death camp was first started in Namibia by the Germans in Africa before they used it.
Also on,
So why don't we talk about the death camps in Africa? Yeah.
But the Germans are in.
Yeah. Also why do we only talk? This is the problem with only talking about German race laws in Germany. It like cancels out any other history. There is a long history of racial exclusion in the United States, and a lot of countries are copying the United States. There always has been a schizophrenic nature to American policy, our laws. you know, you have the founding fathers say all men are created equal while they own slaves. How do you reconcile that, right? But that's been happening all along. Do you know that Native Americans, the first time Native Americans were recognized, okay, first they were excluded from naturalizing, right? They were not recognized as human beings until 1879, Standing Bear versus Crook. And did you know when they were allowed to naturalize? Okay, now they were human beings. Exactly. Yeah.
By the way, I was a former high school teacher and a college professor, and we were obligated to teach what you're just saying.
Okay.
It was part of the curriculum
okay.
for at least 40 years.
Okay. Well, most Americans do not know this history. I grew up in the New York metropolitan area. I was born in New York City. I did not know any of this history.
But I want to point out for the college, not everyone is required to take the history, the American history. When I went to college, I learned about the Japanese after the Second World War. They were sent to the so-called concentration camp, and the government took away their property and.
Yeah, they lost all their property.
They became refugees.
Yeah. And they had no due process.
But the curriculum in the high school, they don't talk about this.
That's
why it's understandable the African American boy doesn't know anything about it.
Yeah, exactly. No, neither does the Asian American girl. We don't know about it either. So I'm just saying that learning about foreign or German race laws is fine, but as Americans, we need to know our own history. We need to know the race laws of this country.
And also, the reason why we have Chinatown, because the Chinese, after I came here, I just learned that besides white people, all other races are considered the people of color.
Yeah.
And my professor put out her hand and she asked me to put my hand next to her. Mm-hmm. She said, our skin doesn't look too much different, but I'm considered the people of the color.
Yeah,
she is considered white people.
Yeah.
And
well, my next project is addressing this. My next project is called, I'm going to call it Buried History, the Plate Project. And it basically, I'm going to make a series. There is forensic legal evidence of race laws, American race laws that are legal, that excludes people that are not white. There's like a whole series of laws that says white by law. This is a legal discrimination. And I am going to create these platters and I'm going to put the laws on them. 1790s Naturalization Act, 1875 Page Act, 1882 Chinese Exclusion Act, the alien land laws. There was like over 800 pieces of legislation, federal, state, and local, targeting Asian peoples. And yet, I was told all my life that there's no discrimination against Asian people. Yeah, that's what I was told all my life. I even worked at NPR for 10 years in Washington, D.C. I worked at WNYC. I knew a lot about the German, what happened, the German race laws, what happened in the concentration camps in Germany. It's not about terminology. It's about what actually happened. And actually, most historical scholars and academics and all agree that they were legally, scholarly, academically concentration camps. We just cannot use it for emotional reasons. And that's what a lot of facts are thrown out for emotional reasons. You can't look at the truth because it's too emotional. But we need to do that. We need to.
I forget to continue.
Yeah.
The reason why there is Chinatown,
because
the Chinese people, they received lynching, and that's why they decide to...
No, there were huge pogroms against Chinese people. They were segregated into ghettos. They were not allowed to live anywhere else. Yeah. No, it's very, very similar. Yeah.
I guess that happened in every country, not only this country, in Germany. United States, not Germany. In Japan, too.
Yeah, no, exactly. Yeah, no, there's... So what I'm saying is that prejudice and bias will always exist. You will always have a bias for your child. You will always have a bias for your church, You know, maybe you'll be prejudiced against, you know, people who like peanut butter. I don't know. I don't like people who like peanut butter. You know, it smells. I don't like it. Whatever. But when it's turned into a law, when it becomes the law of the land, then people who like peanut butter are going to be breaking the law if they're friends with somebody who likes peanut butter or if they eat peanut butter, right? When it becomes the law of the land, that's when you have Nazi Germany. Because prejudice and bias will always exist.
In every country.
Yeah, every country. So
that's almost basically as human nature, but if you look at America, it's actually really unique. Even the white people from it, the Italian got this.
Yeah, I know.
Well, that's why I have hope for America. I have hope for America because there are laws that say that you're not, you can talk about this stuff. You can examine this stuff, you know? That's why I'm proud to be an American. I'm an American, and I just want to say that sometimes an American looks like this.
Yes.
You know, unfortunately, but they do.
But I've heard this story many times.
I originally from Japan, but I lived here for like 10 years, over 10 years. And from my own experience, as being born in a different country, I experience a lot of racism. Even I experience my own. It's not only black and white. Everybody can be a racist.
Well, race matters, and race matters when it becomes the law, when legislators can turn it into law. And if we're just looking at African Americans and slavery, and as if all that, you know, all racism disappeared after that, you're missing a very, very important story. Yeah. And America's a perfect place to talk about this stuff. And it shouldn't be censored because of, you know, you're afraid to hurt somebody's feelings. We need to look at what actually happened. That's why looking at the laws, look up the laws of America, look up the race laws, it's all there. Yeah, so I'm gonna make all these platters, I'm gonna bury it, and I'm gonna let it go through all the seasons, you know, spring, fall, whatever, and I'm gonna dig it up. And the plate, that is my act. It's a conceptual art project. You know, it's art that's trying to express a concept. And that's, so I'm going to document it. I'm going to video, you know, photograph it, whatever. But so that's my next. That's my next. Yeah. Yeah. But.
I have a question.
Oh, yes.
Have you done this in any other place before here?
Yes. Yes, I have. Yeah.
Because I think this is a very educational project. I learned so much today.
Yeah.
And it made me a little sad. But,
I hope it gives you hope. What I'm trying to say is that back in 1941, there was so much fear of someone that looks like me that they rounded up everyone, you know, even children. I mean, 50% of the people in Tule Lake, which was the worst camp of all, that was the No-No Boys, were children. Because the No-No Boys' parents, you know, were sent there, so the children went there too. That's why what's going on today is, like, in some ways even more horrific in the sense that they're separating, you know, children from these parents. These children haven't done anything wrong. They didn't consciously try to break the law or anything, you know? And so at least if you're going to, you know, imprison the parents, let them stay with their parents so that they could take care of them and then, you know, let the legal process happen. But to remove them, now they don't even know which children belong to which parents, you know? And the other thing that the newspapers never bring up is that in the state of Washington, Oregon, all the Western states, there are thousands of Russians, you know, former, you know, Soviet Union, thousands are coming. Now in the state of Washington, Russian is the third most spoken language in the state. Yes. And you don't see them being put into, you know, yeah, or their children being removed, you know. And Trump said the country's full. Well, if it's full for Mexicans or Latinos or whatever, why isn't it full for them?
It's a double standard.
It's a double standard, yeah.
I just wanted to ask you if you've gotten an open arm welcome to, have you approached a Japanese American museum in Los Angeles? Because that,
they know about, they know about me. Okay. Yeah. It's okay. There is, I remember I explained there's a divide in the Japanese American community. That's because the no-no boys thought that we have to fight for the Constitution. We have to fight for the fact that this was wrong. But the other side, the ones, the 442nd, the 100th Battalion, said, obviously, unless we spill blood, they're not going to accept us as Americans. So they said, you know, you have to go fight. You know, if you don't, it's shameful. This will win us the right to be recognized as Americans. And in some ways, they were right. Because of the 442nd, a lot of people, you know, became senators. They got a lot of power. They were able to pass the Civil Rights Act of 1988. Because of that, Reagan signed it, and they were given reparations. And reparations didn't pay for their losses. It was just you know, I mean, people who break their legs on the sidewalk in Manhattan can get more, you know, than the Japanese American got for being, you know, forcibly removed. I mean, it was just payment and acknowledgement of a wrong. It wasn't to compensate for their losses. So when people say you were compensated for your losses, that's patently not true. Yeah.
Financially, they never compensated?
No. Actually, when they closed the camps, they were given $25 and a bus ticket.
$25?
Yep, that was it. And most of them were told not to come back. When they went back, their farms were burned, their possessions were all gone. Yeah. Yes.
I just wanted to say thank you for your courage to share this. And also, I think, you know, it's very emotionally charged. Every time you hear something like this.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, if we didn't learn in a school, we have to still learn.
Yeah.
So I myself, as an educator, because I learned so much, I thought I knew enough, but not enough.
Yeah.
And the learning is going to continue forever.
Yeah.
One time when I was hosting eight survivors, and all the kids were asking questions, and one of the kids said, "What can I do?" And the survivor said, "What you hear today, just share that with your parents and family and friends." And that's the kind of thing we have to do, because we cannot just sort of think about our own ethnicity.
Right,
we have to learn about others as American.
Yes.
And because otherwise, you know, they said, well, our group was more discriminated.
Right.
That's not
Yeah, it shouldn't be like the suffering Olympics, you know? That's not what it should be about. It's more about exclusion and when it becomes law. When it becomes the rule of law, then it becomes serious. Even the people, there were a lot of Americans who tried to help Japanese Americans. They were punished for it, you know? In fact, the truth about Milton Eisenhower, he became the first director of the WRA, and there's this propaganda video that's constantly shown that they created these camps, and we were calling them pioneer communities, and they show all these Japanese people smiling and getting on buses and stuff, and he actually quit 3 months later. Saying that he, you know, he thought that it was wrong. And when Dylan Meyer became the next head of the WRA, he asked him, can you tell me, you know, what do you think about this job? And he said, well, if you could sleep at night, I would take it. I can't. So, and yet, at the Smithsonian, his video is shown time and time again, and it makes him look like he's the champion of mass incarceration, when in fact he had objected to it. And he, you know, he probably had just as a promising career as his brother Dwight, but after that, became persona non grata. Yeah.
One just information, I think some people might know, but after the camps was closed, and all the Japanese Americans went back to West Coast. And actually, the mayor of LaGuardia was asked by State Department to take Japanese Americans, and he said no. So the current mayor has been looking at all these statues in New York to try to take it down. So like, I work at LaGuardia Community College in CUNY, and we have been challenged by the mayor if we're going to do something about it. Either, you know, we're not going to change the name.
Right.
So
Yeah, so LaGuardia, is, if you look at the papers at the time, he was rabidly anti-Japanese. He said, got to get the Japs out. He said, no Japs, you know, in New York. You know, so he was one of the, you know, and he, there were two very, very prominent Republicans that helped FDR in re-election for three times, you know, to be re-elected as president. And that was Earl Warren, which you know about. He was Attorney General of California at the time, became the governor of California, eventually became Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. But he was a former president of the Native Sons of the Golden West, which helped pass anti-Asian legislation after anti-Asian legislation. And you know, he was it was like the Ku Klux Klan of for Asian people on the West Coast. So nobody ever talks about Earl Warren. Earl Warren was, you know, he was really racist. He was also eugenicist. So, and you should look up American eugenics, because it was actually much more influential and had reached, you know, all the elite, you know, Harvard, Yale, Stanford, University of California, Princeton. And as in terms of education is concerned, Princeton University still has no Asian American department. They've been trying to get one for 40 years. And the only way you can learn about it is if you take African American studies, and there's like one class in it that where you might learn a little bit about Asian Americans. So, I mean, this is at one of our top universities. So, and actually in Gray Barrington where I live, the local high school, Monument Mountain, a friend of mine's son goes there. And they were doing Knowing Ourselves, there's a program or something like that, where, and they were doing Holocaust Week in August, this past summer. And, you know, she was, you know, explaining the Holocaust and what happened in Germany. And so my friend's son knew about the Yellow Bowl Project, and he said, well, how about the camps for Japanese Americans in America? And the teacher said to him, I don't know what you're talking about. And he said, well, you know, I think they put, you know, Japanese people into prisons and camps in America. And she said, you're wrong. You don't know what you're talking about. So then he said, I'm pretty sure it happened. And then she said to him, if you continue on this line of questioning, you are going to have to leave, and you're going to have to go, I'm going to send you to the principal's office. That was end of conversation. So this is happening in Great Barrington, very liberal, you know, Massachusetts. And the other thing is, one of the earliest anti-Japanese laws, In Re Saito, was passed in Massachusetts.
But I've watched about that, you know, on Channel 13 many times. That's how I found out. I didn't grow up in this country. I didn't go to school, you know.
Yeah.
But I've watched the public television.
Yeah, no, but they usually teach it as some kind of isolated thing. You know, it's not taught as part of civil rights history. So they don't include, like, Standing Bear. Standing Bear was, you know, an early civil rights activist. You know, 1879. Where's you know, Standing Bear in the story of civil rights? Korematsu. He fought for justice for all people. They never mention Korematsu.
If you read the books, you know, they might know. As a teacher, she doesn't know.
I know, and that's a problem. Thank you. Thank you for coming to my talk and share this story. It's not about me. It's not about me. It's about American race law and the history of exclusion. It's in there. Check our laws.